my name's Amy Mulder, and I teach, I'm the course chair, and I teach in the BioCore 587 course. BioCore is a four-semester undergraduate honors biology series, and I'm actually, I have to leave by 9:30 because I have to be over in Nolan to teach at 9:55 in the first semester of it, the 381 course. So I see the students at the, now I see the students at the beginning, and then I see them at the end of the fourth semester. So BioCore 587 is the fourth semester. They're second semester juniors for the most part when they're coming into this course. Some of them take a year off and come back as seniors, but most of them are juniors. It's the capstone course in the fourth semester honors curriculum. What we want them to do is in the beginning, you know, they go through and they learn the basic biology stuff, and then we, and sort of more traditional, although not always traditional, classroom. And in 587, we wanted them to be able to integrate everything they learned and apply it to real-life situations. So they're investigating the process of scientific discovery. We're reading and evaluating papers. So they are reading primary papers from the scientific literature, something that they don't often have to do at the level we want them to do it. We want them to read them as if they are graduate students presenting a journal club. Okay, so it's a big ask. But they get to it by the end of the semester, and they do really well. And most of them say that BioCore was one of the best experiences they had in college, and that 587 especially taught them how to be and think like a scientist, which is what we want them to do. So that's the course, that's the goal of the course. So they work in assigned groups. They're assigned groups for the whole semester. They don't get to choose their groups, which they don't like, but that's too bad. And they read the papers, we give them background lectures, and then on Wednesday they come together in class and they answer questions about the papers, and we use Moodle for that. We used to use paper. And then, I can't remember how many years ago it was, Dave and I got enlisted by Lil Tong to come to a talk, and Bob Jean was investigating using Moodle and making this thing that they called Feedback Manager to use in, I think he was in 152 or 151, I remember which, it was one of the 151, 152 classes, I can't remember which. Anyway, one of the other biology classes. So I went, and I thought, oh, we could do this online, and we don't have to have paper. I don't have to worry about losing paper. I don't have to read handwriting. There's all sorts of, you know, you guys all know the pluses of it. So we got hooked in and we worked and we spent, Dave and I spent probably a couple years working with people, getting this to the point where we really wanted it and where it worked the way we wanted. I had a bunch of demands going in, and as people who work with me know, I tend to be demanding. But they're all demands that had to do with the pedagogy. So, and then what we do in class, so they answer those, they submit them, and then we grade and come back on Friday and we talk about their answers. And so it's a quick turnaround time. We usually have about somewhere between 80-some and 90-some, sometimes over 100 students in the class. So, and they're groups of four, so we're talking somewhere between 20 and 30 groups of students, and the TAs have to get all this graded and give them feedback, and you'll see what some of the questions look like. There's a team of three faculty, and we all work together doing this. And we use the Moodle and the Feedback Manager as an integral part of the course. So the papers, the study guides, we write our own. The textbooks are just a backup. We give them weekly quizzes and discussion. That's still on paper, because we haven't found a really good way of doing it with opening the quiz and shutting the quiz, unless you go through on every discussion section and open and shut the quiz for every discussion section, which is more of a pain in the ass than using paper. So sorry about that. And then they work in worksheet, and then they have three short answer essay exams, and I'd love it if we could get the students to do the exams online, but they refuse. They do not want to do their exams on a computer. They want to do them on paper. Every year I poll them, and every year the poll comes out almost unanimous that they want them on paper. So that's something that you guys should keep in mind, that if you ask the students what they like when they're writing a short answer essay exam, they do not want to do it on the computer. So, the old way, we gave them one paper copy of a worksheet, and I'll show you what some of the questions look like. We needed to copy them after class, so we had to go up after class, take this stack of papers, put them through the Xerox, because the TAs took one stack and graded them, and the faculty member took the other stack to look at the answers to excerpt exemplar answers for Friday. Because what we wanted was examples of good answers, and examples of answers that were not quite good so that we could show them what was missing in this answer or where this answer went astray. Because the whole point of this is to help them model how to think about how to answer these questions and what constitutes a good answer to a question like that. So that was a pain because try Xeroxing things that people have written in pencil and you're reading, yeah, so they have bad handwriting, and then they're writing in pencil, and you're reading a Xerox copy, and you have bad eyes like me. It was not fun. So when they said you could maybe do this online, I was, yeah, but. So this is what some of them would look like. So here's kind of our questions. And this brings up one of the things that it shows you right away is that sometimes our questions are in, our answers are in tabular format. And we need the table because it not only helps us grade, but it helps the students organize their thinking, right? If we ask them to design an experiment and we show them how many experimental and how many control conditions there should be, they can't leave any out, right? It makes them realize, oh, I need to have three controls for this experiment. What would they be? And if you have this as a essay answer, they would often forget to distinguish between, say, results and conclusions, and you'd have to try to decipher it. This way, it organizes their thinking. So tables are important. And then we have multi-part questions as well. So because we guide them through a thought. We start off with a thought, we guide them through the thought. You guys are going to teach you, you've done this. So our requirements for 587, when I went in and I said, we have to be able to have answers in the template form or some other format, some other template for them to answer. That the students had to be able to work in groups and that all members of the group could get the feedback and have access to the thing online afterwards. So that was the other thing, is that, and we only wanted one person per group to be able to sign in because we wanted this to be a group effort. We didn't want them to do the divide and conquer, where everybody gets on their computer and they all answer a different question, because that just, that's it, you know, then why put them in groups? So we wanted to be able to constrain that. So we wanted to have those rules. And we wanted the students to be able to go back online and see their worksheets and the comments all through the semester so they could use them for studying for the exams. Because that's the whole point. We tell them this is your best material to study for the exam. So they had to have access to them. And we wanted to be able to see the grading in real time. And why is that important? Well, one of the things that we discovered when we had the TAs doing things on paper, we would sometimes get complaints from the students about how a question was graded, because we would show an answer and say it was a great answer, but the TA had taken points off from that. But I had no way of knowing that because I never saw how the TA graded them. Because with our short turnaround, there was no way I could look through all those questions after the TA got them graded before I did my presentation on Friday morning. So now I can go in and see how the TA has been grading the questions. I can give the TA comments on their grading. We can fix all the problems before the students ever see their comments or their grade. And that was something that I never could do on paper. We could only fix things after the fact, and that's not good. That's bad. So that was one of the things that I find really useful. So we can use the short answer essay, tabular response questions. We do the quiz. We use the quiz thing, what Moodle calls a quiz. And we have made it do what we want it to do. I think it probably wasn't designed to do some of the things we do, but it works, and we make it work that way. It's easy, and the using feedback manners is an easy way to provide tailored or mass feedback to the students, and Dave's gonna talk a little bit more about that, so I'm not gonna talk a lot about that. And like I said, I can catch the grading errors. We don't have to worry about, what was that word? I can't read your answer. And we can access them from anywhere. So I can be home at Wednesday night when the TA is grading things, and when I get an email from the TA, I can go online and I can say, oh, okay, here's how I would deal with that question, right? So, which is maybe good or maybe bad, because there I am at 10 o'clock on Wednesday night, you know, answering questions from the TA. But anyway, it works. And sometimes people have had to take an out-of-town trip. If they're out of town, they can still respond to the TA about the grading. And it's a time saver for the graders. Mostly it's because we don't have to guess what we're reading. But not reading the handwriting is the biggest thing. And the other thing that I just put in here, but what we do is, when we grade, what we want to see is all the answers to one question at one time. So we're not grading worksheet A, worksheet 1 for this group, worksheet 2. We're grading question 1 for everybody, question 2 for everybody, question 3 for everybody. That's important because it's consistency in grading. You don't get as much drift if you're grading all of them. And plus then you can, while you're grading them, you can go back and say, oh, okay, I probably should have graded this differently. And it's really easy because you're in the same window. And so you can just go back and correct, you know, like, oh, maybe that's what they were referring to in that question. Okay, I can go back and fix that really easily. So it's really a time saver. I think from my point alone, I'm not even doing the grading, but just from looking through and trying to find example answers, it probably takes me half the time I used to. Which is a big deal, you know. I used to spend pretty much my whole day Thursday looking through those worksheets. And man, too, you had paper, so you had to then, you know, like, either type out the answer or Xerox it, and, you know, I mean, it was a pain. So, this is a lot faster. I can just copy paste and stick a thing into the slide to show them on Friday. So the other things we use Moodle for, which is group evaluations, and I'm going to show you a little bit about that. We have our students evaluate their and their group members' work throughout the semester because we're training them, because for their final project that they do at the end of the semester, part of their grade is their teammates' evaluations of each other. And so we want to make sure that they know how to evaluate each other correctly or honestly and evenly. So we have done a few online discussion section quizzes, but those were special cases. And then they do a project at the end of the semester, and we made them do their proposal as an assignment in Moodle, because we could easily go online and put comments. We have two graders grade each proposal, and so it was easy to go online and grade them without having to download all the things, put the comments on, upload them all, get the next person download them and add the comments. We could be doing things almost simultaneously. And it worked really well. We could see what the other person commented while we were commenting. And we've been using that for the last couple of years since I discovered how to use it. And I really like it. I like that it's online, that I don't have to download a bunch of stuff and then upload it again, that I'm working online, and it's really convenient. So I've been a convert to doing all the online stuff. So. Okay, so here's kind of a thing how we do the question. So here's a three-part question. This is what we see when we're grading. So here's the three parts. Here's the three parts all in one answer, so that we can answer them all at once. So we set this up. We give them an A, B, and C in the answer so that they know when they come in the answer box it says A, B, and C. They answer A, B, and C. Here's the individual feedback that the TA gave. We find that the TAs type a whole lot more feedback than they ever did in the handwritten thing. And they can also assign feedback, and Dave's going to talk a lot more about that, so I'm going to skip that part because we use it, but not quite as much. But you can see how much feedback the TA gave them on this one. So here's another example of where we embedded a table for them to put in a table for part of the answer and then a short answer essay. And this works beautifully because we can answer this whole thing. We've got them organized in a table. We've got a short answer essay. And this is what we see when we're grading. And here's another one where they've got the essay, and that's part of the thing. Here's the experimental design. So we can set it up so that they know how many conditions they have to have. We can tell them how we're going to grade this and what we expect them to have. So it really helps them organize their thinking, especially when they're early in the stages of doing experimental design. So it's really important for helping the students learn how to do this process too. And this is an example of a feedback evaluation. And what I like about this is I have all the students do this, so I have 80-some students do this three times a semester. I give them feedback in every single one of these. So I look at this and what they have to do, it's a 1 to 5 scale, 5 is the best, 1 is the worst. They have to give their teammates, and I blocked off the names, so this is confidential. But they grade each other on all on these factors, and then they have to give a comment, and their comment has to fit their number evaluation. If their number evaluation doesn't fit their comments, I say, these don't seem to fit, or I'll give them some guidance about how they should maybe evaluate each other more fairly. Like, and here too, so that last one I gave a tag, and here this was person so I could do the material better, so I gave them a comment. And it's interesting to me because I go back, and when I look at these, the students do take my comment seriously because the next time they'll actually write something in their comment thing in response to the comment that I gave them to the one 3 weeks earlier. So it's amazing how often they pay attention to this. So it takes me a bit of time, but not as much time as you would think to go through 80 of them because I can look at them really quickly. I'm just looking for disconnects, and then I can, and actually what I'm looking for is dysfunctional groups too. So if we know that there's some group dysfunction, I can go in and help. So it helps me get through that. So here's what the students get when this is an example of that. Here's their answers, here's their feedback, and here I did put the grades in, but they'd also get their grades there. So they get and you can see, this is one of the tags that we use, one of the tag feedbacks. And the students don't know that this wasn't an individual response because they only see theirs, right? So they don't know whether you typed this out just for them or whether it's an answer that you gave to all of the students who answered the question this way. which is, I think, good. So then I'll take this on Friday, I copy paste, and here's what we do on Friday, and right now we're using iClickers, and I give them, here's a question, and I have them, here's three possible answers, and I have them vote for which answer they think is the best answer, and then we discuss it. And these are all answers that the students gave. So they're choosing answers, and then they have to tell me why they didn't choose one of the other answers. So it gets them to think about what's a good answer and what isn't. So it works well. All the answers are readable. Tables help to organize the answers. It's easy and quick to review the answers, and TDs are more likely to give feedback. I have noticed this across all of our TAs, that almost all of the people get feedback because it's really easy to type something in. The faculty can review the grading and the feedback. We can excerpt the answers easily, and it works well for permanent groups. Okay, it doesn't work so well if you have different groups that you're assigning every week, because you have to go in manually and make the group. So I have to sit there at the beginning of the semester and drag students into groups. But because I only have to do it once, it's okay. The limitations. The answers are not constrained. The answers are constrained. We can't have diagrams or drawings. They can't draw yet or do that kind of thing. It would be nice if we could do it. We'll do flow diagrams and that sort of thing, but we don't. No word limit. Oh my God, I'd love to have a word limit because some of the students, even though they only have 50 minutes, they'll end up complaining about their time. They type an answer that, you know, like their answer could have been this long. So I always model the short best answer. It's a pain to set up the manual groups. The grades for missing group members. When they do things as a group, the grade for the miss, if a group member is missing, it still goes into the grade book and we have to manually go in and delete it. It's not a big deal, but it's a big deal. And for the grade book, calculating weighted grades, I haven't figured out how to do it. So we don't use the grade book. I just take the grade book and dump it into an Excel spreadsheet where I've got all the weighting already done and I've got my Excel set up the way I want it and I can just punch the grades in and then the answers come up. So that's how I use it. So that's the end of the show. I don't know if you have any questions for me before
we leave. Just
I can leave at 9:30. So.
All right.
But if you have any questions that are specific to this, I'll be glad to answer them. Try to answer them.
If you do, because mine's going to be different, so we're going to get into different things. So if you have questions, this would be a good thing.
So I was just going to show you that this is. This is what the students see when they come in. Or this is what we see when we're grading, I mean. So when we get the grades, here's the thing, this is what we see when we're grading. And we can scroll through this really quickly. So we can grade them really easily and quickly and fast. Yeah. Yeah, go ahead.
Do you think as you were showing the example, where right there, table, then just want to make sure that the table is being generated by you.
Yes.
You generate the table. They just fill in the blanks.
Yeah, so we put in a table with blanks. Or we can fill in some of the spaces and not others. Sometimes we give them a, you know, like we'll give some of the answers, but not all of them. And the table is pasted in there as part of, you know, basically as a Word document when we set up the questions. Yeah. So when we format it, we're pasting that in there. And then they can just type in. Yeah, so we, and the one on paper, of course, has the table in it as well, right? So we have to create a Word document anyway. So we create a Word document, the TAs take it, the TA takes it and pastes it in here for the answer. So what they would see is a blank table, and then B, you know, and then a space for B, a space for C, and so then they know that they have to type in those answers.
Tables frequently cause problems on some web platforms. Is there any, like, formatting issues with tables?
Occasionally, some of the students will say the table won't let me type in it, but it'll be like one group of students in the whole class and all the rest of them works it, and I think it's more their browser. We tell them to use Firefox because I always test everything in Firefox and it works, and they don't often listen to me. You know, they'll say, well, I'm using Chrome or I'm using that. I'm like, fine, but if you have problems, it's not my problem. I only troubleshooted this in Firefox, and I told you to use Firefox. So that's my answer to that. But occasionally it will happen. But, you know, like I said, it's never been for everybody in the class. It's only been for, like, one group. And so usually what we tell them is we go reopen it in Firefox, and then it works fine. So, yeah.
I really like the tool that you developed. And I was wondering if you are working on something equivalent in Canvas, or
I didn't develop any of this. Dave and I will disavow, I mean, what we did is we worked with Mike and with other people, and we said, here's what we want, make it happen.
So what are you gonna do?
We were the king and the queen on high, you know, like issuing our orders.
So what are you gonna do? What are you planning?
I don't know what I'm gonna do, but that's why when John asked Dave and I to come, and I won't be honest with you, when John asked Dave and I to come, our first thing was, why should we come and demonstrate something that's not gonna exist anymore? Because
the answer that I have is because I think that there might be some workarounds that will go.
Yeah.
If not all the way, then at least make some steps towards reaching some of this.
Yeah,
and I can't think of all of them, but if I invite a bunch of smart people into the room, we might have better luck.
And Mike knows all the struggles that we had. Like at one point they upgraded, updated Moodle and eliminated some of the most important functions. And I found out like 2 weeks before, or maybe a week or so before class started, that things wouldn't work, and oh my God. I wrote a letter to Up on High, and quickly we got, because I was like, we just spent 2 years and $50,000 grant that we got from the university to develop this, and now you've eliminated the functions that we developed. Like, that did not make me happy. And I was like, oh, I'm going to have to go back to paper, because I haven't found anything else that would do what this does. And like I said, I don't know that the quiz part of Moodle was designed to work the way we do it, but the essay answer with template was designed for us, right, Mike? And because I said, I need this. So, because before that you couldn't do it. And so they, I don't know who did it, I don't know how they did it, I don't understand any of that stuff. I know how to use a computer, I know nothing about coding or anything yet. So I have no idea what's behind it. And I know we talked about the word limit thing, and everybody keeps telling me it's hard to do, and I don't understand it, because I don't understand any of this. So I just know I would love to have it, but that's my, my point, and when I came here, I was like, I don't know what we're going to do when they take Moodle away from us, because I can't, I mean, what I've seen in Canvas, there's nothing that's going to do what even comes close to this. So I think we're going to have to go back to paper, which is going to be more than sad. Yeah.
Have you explored any of the external tools that attach to Canvas?
I don't have time for this. I have a full-time job. I teach, I do research. I mean, this isn't my job, right?
There are some that they don't do exactly what you're doing, but they come much closer than Canvas does on its own.
Well, I've been hoping that someone would help us with that, but, it's really frustrating for me as an instructor to have spent all this time getting Moodle to work the way we want. I mean, we invested hours in this.
Oh, yeah. I understand.
And a lot of thought, and now I'm gonna have to do it again? Like, no. So, yeah.
I was gonna say, it's not a fix at all, but if you wanted to still do it online, and you could still sort of create the worksheets, and then the students just download the worksheet.
Yeah, no, okay, so in all the issues we've been having, okay, we want to have 20 groups of students downloading something and then uploading something and working on their computers and doing this, and they have 50 minutes, okay? It has to be time efficient.
I mean, you can.
And it has to work seamlessly.
That's what I was thinking. Yeah.
You know, I mean, the whole idea that they have to download a Word document, type it back in, and then dump it in Box. Yes, we could do that.
It's not, I mean, I guess I'm saying it's a temporary fix.
Yeah.
They generally don't have files.
Oh, well, yes. No, I know they do. I know they do. But, and I know that if the internet goes out, we're in trouble. That's why we give them a paper copy, and we can do it on the paper copy. And I know that, yes, that could work, but it doesn't help the problem with the grading and the feedback.
It's
and
temporary until something else. It's better than paper, right?
Well, maybe, yeah. You know, it depends on the like when they download that Word document, that it works in all their computers, and doesn't the formatting doesn't get all wonky, which, just going between a Mac and a PC, even now, sometimes I just sent something to our course administrator, and when she copied it out, the things had all moved, because the Word document on her computer was somehow different than the one on mine. So there's still those issues. Yes, I mean, we could, but we have something that works beautifully, and it was designed for us.
what about if you were to use Google Doc, for example, you know, where you have the template for everybody stored in a folder somewhere, and so they can update it, and it.
Yeah, I mean, that's the same thing as downloading the things, and yeah, so
you wouldn't have to download it.
Yeah, but then the grades wouldn't automatically be put in anywhere. You know, the advantage of this is that when they get done with the quiz and a grade is entered, it goes in the grade book. The TAs don't have to add up the grades manually. It's
true.
The grades are done. There's no, you know, so that's another step that this has that the other things don't have. So yeah, I hate to be shooting down everything, but we've thought of these things, and it's just a matter of, you know, I'm just like, I guess I'm in mourning because, you know. Well, I mean, we spent so much
of that, right?
The anger stage.
Well, and you know, right now I'm in denial because I'm just going to go ahead and use Moodle next spring and pretend that it's not going to go away. So yes, I'm in denial right now, and my other, you know, my other teammates are as well, and you know, it's just that we have this really great tool, and now it's going to disappear. And we are going to have to find a fix. But that's a frustration, I think, for Dave and I both, is that now we have to spend our time again trying to recreate what we already created. And I'd rather spend my time thinking about how to teach better and how to help my students learn better than to figure out how to make the technology work, right? And I only have so much time. So that's what I'd like to devote it to. So when Mike knows, when we have these meetings, David and I would come in and say, but this needs to work this way.
I'm sure Mike would be very patient.
Yeah.
Actually, it was very wonderful working with you guys, and it wasn't just a case of you said what you wanted and then we went off and built it. It was multiple meetings where we tuned this back and forth communication over and over until we got it to work the way you needed. Which is why it's so darn difficult to replace.
Yeah. Well, and that was the thing, is that, yeah, I mean, it was hours on our part, but also on Mike and his team's part, getting this to, you know, when he'd get this panicked phone call from me saying, this isn't working, I need it to work by Tuesday. And it would magically work, you know. I mean, they get on it and they fix it. But it's because I had this class of students. I had 80 some students who I didn't want them to be disrupted either, right? For them to have to, like, you know, change gears and do something differently when they were used to doing something one way, like when anything would happen, it takes away from the energy they should be spending on understanding the material, right? If they're panicking about the technology, it doesn't do well for them thinking about the science, which is what they're supposed to be thinking about in my class. Anyway, okay. So, yeah.
Just wanted to ask you about one small point.
Okay, you can.
In Moodle, the tables come up, you know, right in the place where the students are going to put their answers.
Yeah.
It's pre-populated.
Yeah.
How much would it mess up your workflow or the student's workflow if, as part of the question, you had the table and you said, copy and paste this into your answer before you start? That as a big impediment?
If it worked all the time,
uh-huh.
That would be okay. The students might find it to be a pain, but if it's, you know, like a 5-second thing, it's not a big deal, but it'd have to work all the time.
As a variation, what if the tables were labeled A, B, C, D across, and then they, in the text answer below, they said A, da 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 da, and that.
Well, you know, sometimes
that visually is
no, and sometimes being able to see the when they're with this isn't a really good example of it, but being able to see in their table, like seeing how they answered one thing helps them see the answer to the other. So that structure also helps them see the parallel between things and the contrast between things. So it's not just a convenience for the grader; it helps the students to see, right? You know that this should be similar to this, or this should be, you know, like there should be a pattern here, right? And if it's just a random text answer, you don't see that pattern, right? So that's the
the teaching part or the learning part of the helping the tables be there. So it's not just a convenience thing. There's also some aspect of helping the students formulate their answers kind of thing.
Yeah. Can you talk a little bit more about the tagged feedback and how that
Gabe is going to talk a lot about that a lot, that's why I didn't talk about that. We use it, but he uses it in a much more sophisticated way than we do. So,
okay,
or complex, maybe. Complex.
So that's better with you, Dave. So as you guys see these challenges and you think of solutions, go out into the activity sheet notes at the bottom there and feel free to add your ideas there or things that maybe we should start looking into. I've already started, but you can add more.
Hi, could I just ask a question? Would it work to do this in Google Sheets and then have the student, so have the student do everything in Google Sheet and then upload that sheet to SpeedGrader? So then
I have no idea what SpeedGrader does.
So SpeedGrader would allow you to do all your fancy grading. I don't know if a Google Sheet will open up in SpeedGrader. Does it?
Yes.
Does it? Okay.
Yeah.
So if you had a Google Sheet that students put this in Google Sheet, it uploaded into SpeedGrader, you could edit all you wanted on that sheet, right? And then in SpeedGrader, you would automatically have a place to have comments and put a grade in.
Stay tuned for this part of the...
Okay. All right. I'll just put it.
But I like what you're thinking.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, see, I guess my issue is, why do I have to think of the answer? I mean, why do I have to come up with a solution by playing with things that I don't know anything about?
Oh, sure.
Because I don't have time to do that. I'm busy, like, right now thinking of 3 lectures a week.
Sure.
And reading. And
okay, I'm Dave Abbott from Obstetrics and Gynecology, and I teach undergraduate class. It's the Introductory Biology 151, 153, and our parent and our sister course 152. We're a 2-semester sequence. We go off in the fall. We are unlike the sort of premier biology undergraduate course that Amy's talking about, that you're looking at really honor students in there. It's an intensive, high-level course. We're really the powerhouse for biology majors for their gateway to go to higher level biology classes on their way to graduating with a biology major. So we have classes of about 350, mainly sophomores in them. We now do a model where there are 3 of us teaching in a semester. And I'm in the 151, 153 part, which is the fall semester every year. So I do 2 lectures back to back at 11 a.m. and 12:05. There are about 350 undergraduates in each one, mostly sophomores. About 40% start out saying they're going to be pre-meds. That whittles down as we go. So there's some form of biology they're after. Okay. This is a 5-credit course. It's not only lectures, we have a 3-hour per week lab. It's run by a TA coordinator. We have discussion sections that meet for 75 minutes once a week to back up the lectures. And we have 5 TAs that run the discussions, and one coordinator, Jean Heights, who couldn't be here today because we're teaching now as well, and she's on with our sequences, who actually puts Moodle into the setup and interfaces a lot with whomever is doing this to make it all happen. I, again, am a user because I come in at the end of the semester sequence, so I'm coming in for about the last 5 weeks to give my lectures on animal physiology, and I integrate the previous cell and molecular and genetics in doing this at the end. So I've got to get their attention as being on other subjects and off the fact that, hey, the semester's about finished. and focus them very quickly on not letting, it's coming up to Thanksgiving too, going, well, we can just coast a little, which is what I found out was happening, because I started teaching in 2000, and then realized that if I didn't somehow grab the students' attention, no matter what I said, they would blow this off for a week or two and then realize they were hopelessly behind. Okay? This was trying to get, first of all, timely engagement of students on task, but to do it in a positive, encouraging way in the classroom. So the Moodle bit, the feedback manager that I'm going to be talking about, was part of this. It's not just the only thing, it's part of this. So I basically employ now 30-minute slots of my 14 lectures to actually engaging the students in a Scantron part, so it's paper. So we get them doing peer instruction in the classroom for six lots of 30 minutes in there. For three of those, which is where we need feedback manager, we get them to write short answers. Because our, again, Lil Tong was brilliant in helping to put all this together in terms of improving the pedagogy. So they put in their own words to some more open-ended questions, short answers, and they thought, oh yeah, this is easy. Totally tried to do it. And then they said it was hard. And then they realized they didn't understand the subject, which is why we really want to try and retain this, because we are a massive throughput with few actual faculty doing it, few coordinators, and the TA hours have been really restricted because we used to go way over the limit.
Well, we did too. Our TA still grade way more than they're supposed to.
Yeah, okay.
I didn't say that.
You didn't say that. Oh dear. We do now, we did, the administration was great. They came and they now give us paid graders outside. So what I'm going to tell you about, the graders are TAs, but they're paid for this outside the classroom teaching, but still compliant with the TA contract hours, okay? So we're behaving ourselves, okay? I'm trying to encourage students to solve problems and realize, listening to each other, they actually learn a lot about how to work through the material. And I do this starting in the second lecture. So there's no let up for them to realize what they're facing. And the whole point of this is to give them early, timely, focused feedback, okay? And the feedback manager comes in when we do the short answer bit, because that means we've got 2,100 answers to grade in about 3 weeks and get it all done, and then there's the end of the semester. So this is not something that can be done slowly, and we can't, and we are employing two graders to do this now. Okay, the three exercises I still use this in are, basically the first one we'll focus on is negative feedback. That's an overriding concept in there. They usually have in class, they've got 70 multiple choice questions to work through. They'll work through from spitback so they realize what they need to know, to problem solving where they can't Google the answer. They can't learn it, they've got to problem solve it and help each other do that. And then this is it, the open-ended limited response question 18 is online outside class. And they have 2 days after each one of these to go online, the website opens up, they get the link access to it, and we provide guidance that they should make their answer in Word or some word processor beforehand, refine it. Limited to 100 words, we don't have a word limiter either, and we try and try and try and threaten them, we're going to cut it off at 100 words, and it helps, but yeah, it's 100 something or other, but okay, provided it isn't 200 or 300 or 500, we're okay. So we can actually focus them to what are you need to organize your thoughts and say this in a concise way, and you can say it in many different ways. Yeah, they don't particularly like that either. So this is what happens when everything gets going. There are people wandering around all over the place and so on, and then they go to Moodle afterwards. So it really gets them focused. And the one point I want to say is, little did follow-up small group responses and so on to try and work out, and Amber Smith as well, who's now back with us, she was a postdoc at the time working on this, that basically if we asked them anonymously how much did the in-class exercises, including the short answers, help them in their learning, we got over half saying extremely or very, or 34% somewhat. How much did they like doing it? It's like Kofnitzin, you know, it's going to help you.
We get the same sort of thing. They don't like going through 587, but if we ask them a year or two later, they say, I realize how much I learned.
Yes.
So it comes back later.
and they say, you woke us up to that we have to think.
Yeah.
We just spit back, do it, spit back, do it. What do you mean I've got to actually be able to problem solve? Was a novelty, and it's getting worse and worse as a novelty. They have less training in that, and this comes as a real shock. So we now have evening classes that we set up for the students who just panic with this. They go, it's okay, it's okay. This is what you can do to work through it. And we've installed those, and we've engaged diversity training and part of this, and the whole class as well. And that what's really happened is, in doing this, we have raised grades, and we lost some of the minorities to begin with. We brought them back up now, too. So at least those scoring 80% and higher, there is no achievement gap. We've still got it at about 5% below that. So we're working on that. Because we have big numbers. Minority numbers are still small, but because we're doing this every year, we're thousands in the non-targeted minorities, but we're now getting hundreds in the targeted minorities. So we're getting data we can work with. And that's why what we're talking about is so important.
Quick question.
Yes.
In the moment.
Yes.
Why is it they don't like it? Is it they don't like the stress of it? They don't like the having to work with other people in that kind of kind of time crunch or what?
Okay. It's not the interactions, because they can choose that picture I showed you. Some were just focusing on their own. Others were getting up and moving around and talking to half the class. Some were information foraging. They go off and they chat to people and they come back to their group and the whole group would come over. What'd you find out? And they go, oh, yeah. They're like, oh, no, that's not right. And Lil caught this all on because we videotaped it and we got, we're telling them what we were doing and so on. And we'd only videotaped part of the classroom. So we caught all this, a whole variety of things. We have to kick them out of the classroom. To get that lot out of there, when they're doing one of these exercises, we are literally shooing them out of the door because they are into this. No, that's not what they don't like. They don't like we make them think. They cannot just sit there and go, okay, yeah, fine, I'll deal with this. Just have a mentally easy ride. But they get it and they get and get. Basically, they would not like to be engaged like that. But when they're doing it, they're earnest. It's not as if they're upset or anything. They are in it. They're in the moment. And it's amazing, by the time you get to the end, they've got this down. Oh,
so it's lethargic.
Yes, there are people leaping up. They know exactly who they're going to talk to and what they're going to haggle over. And it's great to see that in the classroom. It's just, well, it's a room, but we just move around in here. It changes the whole dynamic.
The other thing is that there's always the people who they think they know the answer and they don't want to talk to anybody else because they might find out that maybe they don't know the answer. or that they have to then question their answer. They don't like being challenged.
Mm-hmm. There's another one.
Yeah, and group work always, we actually tell our students one of them has to have the role of being a challenger every week, that they have to question the group answer. That is their job every week, to say, are we sure about this? Is our reasoning correct? And they hate it. They hate it at first. They like it toward the end. They learn to like it, but it's hard. They don't like that part of it.
No. So where does the technology come in with Arbit? Okay, with Arbit, it is the short answer question. We just cannot, I used to do all these until 2 years ago, I did them all myself. And then the state I would get in at the end of the semester, my colleague said, you've got to stop doing this. Yeah. We're going to get graders to do this. And you'll see how we work this. Basically, this is an example of the first question, where it's saying, in your own words and in complete sentences, you have to say that. Totally no more than 100 words, underlined, but we don't have a cutoff, so yeah. Briefly describe the concept of negative feedback with reference to testicular testosterone. Full stop, and then there's a more specific thing I asked them as well at this part of it. So it's an open-ended question. They can, and they can. But it makes them focus on what's important, how do I have to organize my thoughts? And we can give them very quick, timely, specific feedback because this is just, these are examples. So we've got 700 in here. And this is just the first one that just happens to be up because this is by the time of submission. So here's the answer. And then I used to do that, but now we have TA graders that come in, they go, oh, we're going to give this L. Now, what's going on here? Over the years, because I've been doing this since 2007, so I've developed tags that are basically alphabetical letters that are in here. Here's the tag bank that I set up for the graders, and they can add their own. This is not a limited list, and it's a written out answer. And these tags can be put in order so that you can do more than one of them, and the sentences go together to give a complete feedback. Okay, so that's one. The individual feedback is, oh, I've never seen how you could get this wrong this way before.
That's a new way of looking at it. And you write the first, Dave's answer first, then you erase it, and you write mine second.
And you have to give individual feedback. There's just no way out of it. There's nothing, and yet we'll probably never see this again. And so that's there too. And then they get stored because it is graded. So I do it in halves. So they can go from, if they've just got something in there, they get half. Okay. Then to get everything, they've got to have deliverables in there that the graders know. Okay. And we discuss it, but sometimes there are fuzzy areas. Who is the quality control? Me, and I'll tell you how we get to that in a minute. But there's a whole list here, and then the TAs add on. But I can go in and see what they've done. Again, the whole thing, I can see what they're, how they put in tags here, and I can go and see what individual feedback they've given. Because what happens at the end of this is the TAs then tell me, oh, okay, we're finished. So I can come into this and hit send feedback. And what this does is cheat, okay? What it does, it sends out an email to every student from me. So it looks as though it's come from me, and this is the generic template that we worked out with Mike and his team. That basically, this would be the negative feedback quiz, up there would be the title. Here's the feedback for the recent quiz, and it would be fully in there. Then those tags would go in here in their written English, individual or already pre-packed, in a certain order. You know, we can go L-A-Q. It doesn't have to be A-L-Q. We can rearrange it and put in where we want, and the individual feedback, I think, comes at the end. You can view the graded quiz here, and that comes up with what they got for it. And then we tell them, because they're going, this is a huge course. How does that change my overall grade? So we give them the actual math they have to do to put their number into place, okay? And then my usual sign off to them, they've got used to it now, cheers. And that would be my name there, okay? So if they disagree with the answer, they email me. So I deal with all the hiccups and what they don't like, not the TAs. But I can go in and see what the TAs did, and if I still don't understand it, I can ask the TA graders as well. Okay? So, but this means very, with a quick turnaround, because we've just got a short amount of time, especially the students that aren't on the ball. Where are they missing out? They're totally missing out on that understanding of that concept is going to pervade the whole lecture series. They don't get this. They love to learn scenarios. So they will learn, thank you, Amy, 23 scenarios
not the concept.
Yeah.
Once.
They like to memorize.
Yes. And I am going, and we all take them out of their comfort zones. But we take them out of the comfort zones in supported, controlled, challenged ways that we've set them up for it. And then we give them timely feedback on how they're doing, so that when they come to the exam, and I give, we, in our section, I give them two goes. If they do the first exam for each of our three sections, and they bollocks it up, they have, within 2 days, another exam to do. And it's not, well, it's a mixture of the first exam. No, no, it's a new redo. Yes, we have to write two exams each time. But it's to allow the students to realize we set up of quite a few of the questions in this Scantron, and the bits we're getting out of these short answers are what we will challenge them with in the exam. So it's setting them up for what they're going to be facing and what they're going to be facing in higher courses and professional life and anything. Get information, synthesize it, be able to put it back in a coherent elevator speech way with these answers. And so this is what goes out to them. And now the grades, Jean Heights, if she were here, would tell you how she then, in part of this is a grade book that comes up with all the student numbers and answers and grades that she then, I think, then downloads into an Excel file.
I don't know how she does it.
Yeah, she ultimately works out of Excel files. So somewhere in that process, that's what translates. This again, as you heard Amy say, she can lift it out of Moodle and put it into Excel. You guys worked out a similar thing here to put it in. So that helps us with the actual grade, and this helps the students. Yes?
Are you able to get any of like the data analytics on what like the most common tag feedback is, so that you could identify what the most common sort of disconnect is between the student learning to kind of go and then reteach maybe that concept or part of the topic?
Oh, that's a good question. We do not do that. We get a good idea from just looking through the answers, what's coming, and I get a feedback from the graders, what they think. So it's not quantitative, but it's qualitative. And they got used to the way this works now. And I got used to it. I could feel when I did it personally, I could qualitatively give you an answer. This year, yes, they cannot get the concept of there are components to negative feedback. So that if one doesn't work, the whole system doesn't work. You know, you have the concept, just apply it. But now I'm one step removed from that. I have to rely on them to give me that information. So that's the way we're doing it. We didn't set it up to actually be able to go through and extract that information. That wasn't a layer we put in there. But put it this way. I would love to have, okay, long story short, I'd love to have that. Absolutely. We just, if that could be done, basically I'm the same as I am a plug and play. So I know what I want and what we've developed for getting these students in high numbers, targeted, timely feedback. Doesn't matter what ethnic group they come from, we're supporting them. And we're doing that in various ways outside the technology. But the technology is enabling it to happen. If this goes away and we can't find an equivalent, paper's not going to do it. We will just go, well, we're going to, new technology, teaching regression. We're going to find the main powerhouse for introductory biology is going to go back.
So let's take some time and pull on you guys and your ideas and thoughts. Having heard what you've heard today, what are your thoughts? I mean, they've got a well-oiled but very complicated system of feedback. Do you have any ideas of how to do parts of it, all of it, any of it in Canvas?
Just real quick, if I could, have you had a chance to look at the SpeedGrader functionality in Canvas yet?
I haven't, no.
Okay, that's fine. Because it was brought up earlier, Amy also had not, I think that needs to at least be explored long enough to see how much of a matchup there can be.
Yeah. SpeedGrader will give the timely feedback, it gives individual feedback through the inbox to all the students, It has the different rubric-y type things, but the, I remember having this discussion with you, they would then be able to see all different pieces of feedback, and they don't want them to see all the feedback and just say, oh, you just got number L, pay no attention to, or number L, L, letter L, pay no attention to A through, you know, whatever the 4L. And the Google Doc thing, I think, is a really good thing. You'd be able to do tables there, you could create worksheets that have them fill that out. And I think the speed grading stuff would be very easy to, for you guys to be able to see the TA feedback, things like that. It doesn't give them a lot of the choose from the tagged feedback, although I think you could use some of the text expander things. We've got a list of different types of text expanders, clipboard managers, things where you can start typing and it'll autofill out whatever L was. So you can have that sheet next to you and then just start typing a couple of letters and there it is. So there are several little solutions that we've been able to think of, but any others?
Just a clarification, the DAC feedback, you specifically developed that for each question that you ask, or do you ask the same question, you know, from semester to semester for the students to answer? And I was thinking maybe the DAC feedback, it seems like it could be kind of incorporated into a rubric that would fit in SpeedGrader. But I don't know, I mean,
All ideas welcome. Put it this way, we are basically set to teach. I am not a teacher, I'm a researcher, and I'm in here basically as a volunteer. So quite a few of us are in introductory biology because it wouldn't work otherwise. It's a huge powerhouse. So we basically work with, it used to be the technology support, to add that to our system, but we wouldn't do all these bits you were talking about that you are integrated with. We'd want somebody to tell us, yes, there is that available, and we could work on this to give you what you want. Absolutely. So all these ideas are great if we can find somebody who would then engage all that with the new system that we could now work with. And the tags you asked about. Actually, I've worked out, I have now bellwether questions in exams that have been there for 10 years. I know, why do I keep them unchanged? Okay, the options, they're the same, but the order changes. They're guaranteed to get about 50 to 60%, you know, for this one, about 80 to 90% for that one, 90% plus for that one. I keep them in about 10 to 12 every year, unchanged, because they're like a quality control. The students, you'd think, oh, but they tell everybody the answers. No, they don't. Don't you? It's the same question that for 10 years, it's probably all over the internet, because we have to hand them out, as we do at the end and everything. It's the same question all the time. The tags are fine, because they've been developed over the years. And the TA graders, fresh young minds, add some nice new ones that they think be better, so they don't get rid of A, they just put in L. I think that was that first one got top grade, so it was a good answer. I would have given A moving on. They probably got, I can do better than this, I'm gonna put an L. And they use L, and that's great. So it allows that sort of variation too. But does that help you?
Thoughts, ideas? Any other things you'd like to see in giving feedback? The timely feedback is really interesting, and Amy had mentioned looking at the PA's feedback before the students get the feedback. Would there be a way to, and I imagine, of course, if you don't do that, it's messy, because then you've got to go and clean up afterwards. And yet we know that in, you know, the sooner you can be able to give that feedback to the students, the closer, right?
Okay, these courses are different with different needs. What I found with these graders, I just did not have the time to go through all that they've done. So I just unleashed it and waited for the comeback. There was very little. And when it was, I found there were understandable, okay, out of 2,100, I think I dealt with less than 20 individual responses back. I forget what fraction, that's a very, very low percentage. So most students were, could understand why they got the feedback, why they got the grade, and I'll tell you, if they don't, I hear about it, it's not as if they blow it off. Yes, it's a fraction of a fraction, but they still go for it, because it could just get them over from, say, you know, a C to a B, or a,
I remember that half point.
Yes, right. It is worth it to them, because they know it's going to come down to that, if they're not already well in the middle.
The thing that I think is brilliant about this tagged feedback is, by having all of the feedback on the side, you're easing the PA's job. They don't have to come up with the feedback. They just have to, like, match. It's like a matching thing. Like,
Yes. Oh,
I recognize that something here, this actually applies to this.
Yes.
And so in some ways, it's offering quality control and some level of sort of norming among the different graders, because they're at the level where they can recognize for sure, even if they might not be able to say it in a way that speaks to the individual student's answer, which you've been able to do over the years.
Yes.
We find that.
Yes, so it basically helps the graders to realize what's coming up, why these tags are there. I give them examples of good answers from the previous years.
Great.
And we set that out after the students have done this. I send out student good answers. So you can see. So I got almost nothing. Oh, that's a good answer, and that's another, and that's, so they can see from the student's own words, not mine, but TA's, what were good answers in the past. And if we get nice short ones that are good answers, then we just add new ones to it. So it is very useful that way too, to turn around the student's own words back to them. So if they're floundering, they can say, oh yeah, that was written by one of my fellow students. I can see the misspelling and the few, you know, we leave that in. So they feel pretty good top marks. So it gives them an idea of what they need to aim for. And it does it right in the first part of my 5 weeks before we're getting so close to the end of semester and they're up to here with all final exams. They've got an idea of what's coming in a fairly targeted way.
I want to respect your time. It is now at 9:45, so you guys are done. I think we've got the room until 10 o'clock. And Dave, if you're available, that would be great if you have other individual questions to ask. Please help me thank Dave for coming. And